Welcome back to Spey Fishing with Jon. I'm Jon Hazel of the Ashland Fly Shop, and today we have a special guest, Steve Eadie from Ashland, Oregon.
Thanks for bringing me.
Steve's a local Rogue Valley guide, and we've fished and hunted together for years and decided to have him on this adventure. We're doing a two-day overnight float on a river on the southern Oregon coast, and we're chasing winter steelhead, so stay tuned and we'll see what we can do. Steve usually catches a fish when he fishes with me, and I usually go skunk, so I might just low hole him all day. All right, folks, well, here we are. We're on a southern Oregon winter steelhead coastal river. We're about 30 miles from the ocean. And we're gonna kind of walk through this spot and how I think I wanna fish it. The thing about winter steelhead is that water conditions change every day. And so you have to kind of read the river. It's a different river every day. You gotta reread it every day you fish it if you're on it multiple days in a row. We just have one day on this particular stretch, so we're making our best guess. I've gotten to this piece of water here, and you know, right now we have fairly clear water. We've got a bright sun, not the best conditions, but we do know that there's fish moving. So at this time of day with these conditions, I feel like I got to get down. These fish are going to be hiding as they move up, and they do move up fairly quick. They'd like to move up on the fringe, but as the sun gets higher and brighter and the water clears up, those fish are going to be out in the depths a little bit more. So Steve and I are jumping in this run with our intermediate lines. It's a Skagit, Rio Skagit iFlight, and it's got an intermediate section, and then we put a sink tip on the end of that. So we're gonna see if this line system works here. If it's too heavy, we'll go a different route, but that's our best guess, and that's what you gotta do winter fishing. Hope you make the right decision. You put it in front of a fly, fly in front of a fish, and hope they eat it. All right, we'll see if we can get done here. So as I jump in here, I'm looking at this water. It's a little fast. So it just starts to turn the corner and quiet down in here. So I'm gonna jump in right here, and it's kind of shallow, medium speed. And then as it turns the corner, it deepens a little bit. So if I had to guess, I'm gonna have an encounter somewhere in here, or just as this flat spot dumps into this, the head of this hole here. Let's start fairly short. I don't need to start real short. You know, any fish that's within 20 feet of me's spooked already, so no point in starting in my lap. They're gonna be in broken water. If they are moving up the edges, they're gonna move up really quick. There's a lot of different water types. You know, when we fish close to the ocean like this, we're looking for traveling lanes. We're looking for what I call a slow down water, just water that slows them down. That could be a tail out. It could be a just kind of a classic riffle run. But these fish are on a mission to get up river, and they don't slow down for much. So we're really trying to intercept them in those spots that A, we can get a fly in, and B, that we think is a traveling lane, slow down water. And then there's holding water. That's the third type of water type. And there's definitely holding water on this stretch. And the holding water really is water that's really hard to fish because it's going to be up against that bank, super deep, up against those boulders on the other side. It's along that slot. So that's kind of tough for us to fish. As we get down into it, I'm going to cast it as far as I can, and with this intermediate, I'm going to be able to flirt with the hole, flirt with the holding water. I'm not necessarily going to be able to get in it. If the water had a little more color to it and the sun wasn't so bright, I'd be fishing a lighter sink tip, or I'd fish just a regular skagit with a kind of a medium sink tip, and I'd be fishing this fly all the way to the bank. But I just don't have any confidence these fish are going to be coming right up the edge under these conditions. So I'm cutting my swing off a little short, and that way I don't hang up and save a little time. Every cast counts. Every cast counts. You just don't know when it's going to happen. You get in those big runs like this one where it's cast, mend, swing, step, repeat. Basically, you know, not every swing is the same, so you're not always gonna mend the same, or because the requirements are different. But in this particular case, it pretty much is cast, mend, swing. But I like to make a fairly good mend. In this case, I need to make a big mend because my fly is landing in pretty fast water. But I often do what I call a fixer mend. So I make my first mend, I keep the rod elevated, and then I make what I call the fixer mend. And I'm really just mending the back of the spey line, the shooting head. So that floating section of this eye flight is perfect for my fixer mend. So I'll show you right here. There's my big first mend. If I get my rod elevated, I can just kick a little mend in that the back of the shooting head. And it just helps slow my fly down, give my fly time to come around out in front of my sink tip, and then get a nice even swing. You throw a real big mend and then just leave it, doesn't always work real well. So I like that little fixer mend. It's just a tiny little adjustment, but it makes a difference. I'm fishing my old, it's not too old, but it's a Sage 12 and a half foot 7 weight TCX, known as the Death Star, and it's a rod I will never get rid of. At 12 and a half feet, it's great on small water, tight quarters. It's fast. There's a fish. There he is. He was on. He ate it. He ate it. Man. All right, I'm gonna check my fly. Once in a while that hook gets fouled, you get grabbed. I'll just make sure I'm not fouled. Got grabbed, Steve. Okay, we're clean. Must not have wanted it that bad.
Pretty sure I just saw a fish scoot up.
You saw a fish scoot up?
I think so, just kind of right in there.
All right, buddy. Well, I fished with Steve a lot over the years, and Steve's my bad luck and I'm his good luck. He always catches a fish when we fish and I don't. So we're gonna try to change that on this trip. I get asked a lot, you know, when I do a spay clinic or I have private instruction or I'm guiding, I get asked a lot about managing line and when you're shooting line. So once you start shooting more than 10, 15 feet of line, you gotta have some kind of system to gather your loops, hold your loops. And there's a dozen different ways to do it. Everyone kind of has their own technique. Some guys count, some guys measure. Some guys will hold a loop in each finger. For me, I just strip in my shooting line till the current takes it down to the tip of my rod. That's usually about 5 strips. And then I'll do 4 strips. and then I'll do three strips. So I'm gathering a loop in between each one of those. So five strips, gather my loop, four strips, gather my loop, three strips, gather my loop. And I just keep all the loops in my index finger on my bottom hand. And as long as everything goes right, they go out just fine. All right, so I've just skipped this middle part here. There's a back eddy. I'm still kind of in the back eddy, but I'm trying to cast far enough to get over the back eddy so I can get out in that main current. All right, well, I just fished that whole run. I got one grab. Steve saw a couple fish moving. You know, what's not to like? It's a beautiful day. We don't get many days like this in February on the coast, winter steelhead fishing. And I'll fish a run like that any day in February and get skunked and be just happy with it. So on to the next spot. We'll see what it has for us. Every winter steelhead is a gift, and they're few and far between. We drove 4 hours this morning, left around 3:45, drove 4 hours to get here, just for the chance of seeing our backing. These fish, you know, this close to the ocean, they're gonna rip ya. And just feeling that power, it's worth the trip.
This may be the first fish I've ever seen Jon catch.
Oh, wow.
Ready? Right here, John.
All right, you hoist him up there, Eadie.
There you go.
There's evidence that I actually can catch a fish when Steve
Eadie
is present.
Nice chrome bright, too.
Nice wild fish.
Let's let him go.
Awesome.
Fucking A.
Thanks, bud.
Nice job.
Yeah, yeah, we got one.
All right, there is hope.
Yes.
Well, good morning. Jon Hazlett here. We had a great night's sleep. We're stoked to get out this morning. Steve's already fishing, so stay tuned and we're gonna go chase some winter fish. Well, we got one right in front of camp here last night. These winter fish, when they're coming up, they're coming right up the willow line. You can see the willow line out in front of me. This is a little kind of cove here where a channel comes in, right in front of our camp. Actually really nice water. These fish are just constantly on the move down here. So I'm just fishing this little cove here just to see if maybe a fish snuck in here to take a breather.
So we're fishing the second spot of the day, day two on the Rogue River. And just working the fly out deep slot. So I'm fishing a big intruder, 10 foot of T11 and a 550 intermediate skagit on the 12-4 8 weight Beulah. This is a new spot to swing and it's just sets up beautifully, but it's deep. Just trying to find out how much I can cast comfortably. Once I hit my limit, I'll start working down the run. Every day my limit's a little different. Watercolor's really nice. About, there's a fish. Oh, he's off. Probably pulled up a little bit quick. Nice. I love it. That is why we're here. Oh well. One thing I've learned in this game is not every cast has to be perfect. All you have to do is get a good swing. Just let that ride down, set up the swing. Oh, beautiful. Earlier in the day, I was fishing a slightly lighter fly and just didn't have the feeling I was getting down. So I went to the biggest fly I've got in my box. Just need to get down in front of them. And what was that, the fifth, sixth cast and produced fish. So just keep changing, just keep changing. If I have a fish take, I will slow my pace moving down. Instead of my typical five steps down, I'll slow down to two steps or so. Because if that fish was there, there's something he likes there. And I want to work through that spot carefully. That's one of the things that's nice about spey fishing for me is I'm not just casting. I get to land my fly, set up the swing, and I get to enjoy the view. I actually like the double spey cast for water like this when it's that deep because I can land it further upstream. Get that fly sunk down a bit before I start my swing. But the snap T is probably my stronger cast. So I always mix it up.
Well, Steve, it's been super fun fishing with you as usual. We've been so busy fishing, we haven't had time to chat. So let's talk steelhead. For a first-time steelheader, what advice would you give them?
Number one thing I could say is get a good instructor, get the basics down, but you've got to remember to enjoy it. When you start getting frustrated, pause. Step back and ask yourself why you're here. With the help of a good instructor, getting your technique down and enjoy.
How about somebody, and I agree totally, how about somebody that's gone from summer steelhead to winter steelhead?
Going from summer to winter, you need to adjust your expectations a little bit. I mean, on summer fishing trips, you know, we can hook three, four, sometimes five fish a day. Winter, if I have a grab in the day, I'm happy. Okay. If we can hook two or three in a day, even better. As far as the tackle's concerned, think bigger water, bigger gear. That's kind of how I go about it.
Yeah, and speaking of gear, you hooked a fish earlier today briefly.
Yes, I did.
Tell us about some of your favorite spey outfits and the lines you like on them.
Well, my two primary rods for this time of year, I've got a Beulah 12'4" 8-weight Platinum, which is a great rod, loves short lines, 550 intermediate on it. That's actually what I hooked the fish on today.
And that's the Rio iFlight.
The Rio iFlight 550 with a large intruder up at the top of that run. The water was faster, so I could fish that. As we got down into that run, slowed down quite a bit and I started losing flies, so I switched over to a 7-weight. And my favorite there, I love the Sage 7136 with a 525 iFlight or sometimes even a Skagit, compact Skagit. I like that rod, keeps me just a little shallower. And as someone told me once before, I make casts that I shouldn't be making with it.
Yeah. Well, we haven't hooked a lot of fish, but I'm really enjoying our trip. And appreciate you coming on it.
No worries.
Look forward to fishing with you again, buddy.
All right, buddy. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, that's a wrap, folks. Thanks for tuning in to Spey Fishing with Jon. Special thanks to my buddy Steve Eadie and cameraman Chris, the Ashland Fly Shop. We'll see you next time. Thanks for watching. I know what boys like.